I'm Andy Allard, and in this month's In Deep, we'll be looking at the guitar playing of legendary acoustic Delta blues guitarist Robert Johnson, guitarist, singer, songwriter, affectionately known as King of the Delta Blues Guitarists, or King of the Delta Blues Singers, as that first very famous album was called. And Robert Johnson is one of the most influential guitarists ever. People like Eric Clapton, Keith Richards, Jimi Hendrix have cited him, and Cream got famous for playing one of Robert's tunes, which is their seminal version of Crossroads, originally called Crossroad Blues. And his life story is sort of shrouded in mystery. The story that, as it is that Robert was a player that was on the scene of somewhat standard ability, and he disappeared for a little while, and then when he came back, his playing was astounding. So the legend was that he had sold his soul to the devil at the crossroads, which is where Highway 49 and Highway 61 meet each other. That's what the crossroads is. And a lot of his songs, there are a few songs like Hellhound on My Trail and Me and the Devil, have sort of perpetuated that myth about his pact made with the devil. But no matter what, he was an incredible guitarist, and his original recording sessions encompassed 29 songs, primarily original songs, that have been played and interpreted by a variety of guitar players through the years, and he continues to be one of the most important players. And one of the things he did was, with his finger-picking technique, he could create the sound of more than just one guitar player at a time by playing in counterpoint and playing bass lines on the low strings or rhythms, hitting rhythms with melodic figures on top, oftentimes sounding like two guitar players. So Clapton and Jimmy Page, Keith Richards, all those guys spent a lot of time in their early years trying to decipher his playing. And thus, there's still a lot of conjecture about exactly how Robert did the things that he did, what some of his tunings were. There's arguments about the speed of the records. But anyway, in this lesson, I'm going to break it down for you best I can, show you some parts from classic tunes like Sweet Home Chicago and When You've Got a Good Friend, Stones in My Pathway. Now, Robert used primarily four different tunings, and then he would use a capo and change the capo setting. And those tunings are standard tuning, and then he would use open G, open D, and drop D. So I'm going to try to show you examples in this variety of tunings in this lesson. All right, let's start off with standard tuning, which Robert used for the majority of his songs, I believe. Some of those songs would be Sweet Home Chicago, When You've Got a Good Friend, Kind-Hearted Woman Blues, Steady Rolling Man, Love in Vain. All those songs are played in standard tuning, some of them with a capo. So let's tune up first. This is standard tuning concert pitch. Here's E. A. D. G. B and E. All right, we're going to start with Sweet Home Chicago. Sweet Home Chicago, as I said, is played in standard tuning, but with a capo at the second fret. So we're going to use all our normal chord positions as if the song were in the key of E. But we're keeping it at the second fret. So when you look at the transcription, zero is an open string, even though it's represented at the second fret. And then all the tab that goes along with that is going to be relative to the capo. So this, which is actually the 14th fret, in the transcription is going to say 12th fret because it's 12 frets above the capo. So this next example, this is the intro and the first verse of Sweet Home Chicago. One, two, three. All right, so it starts with a pickup bar. One, two, three. So I'm just playing that 12 frets above the capo, 14th fret. And I'm picking with my middle finger, and I'm using a plectrum for the lower notes. Robert Johnson used a thumb pick. The best way to replicate that without a thumb pick is to hybrid pick. Use a pick held between the thumb and index finger, and then use the other fingers for picking. So it opens up with the classic turnaround, just starting on the high note first. One, two, three. So I'm walking down that D string. So starting in the second bar. So all against that high root note. So from the beginning, one, two, three. And then right there, I'm gonna switch to this, which is like an E seventh chord. And then I'm gonna jump to B7. And this is just like a normal B7 like that, 2-1-2, but with the thumb fretting the low F sharp bass note as well. So you can do that. And then I come into the verse. So I start with I'm hammering on to the G string at the first fret, one fret above the capo, and the A string, two frets above the capo. And a little palm muting, and walking up. So before I get to that A seventh chord, the second chord, here's the first chord where he sings, come on. Right there, I'm gonna pick the G and then pick the open high E along with A5 on the bottom. So you get that upper voice with the lower voice. One more time. So you work in that G string at the end of the phrases. One more time from the beginning. Okay, so now this is bar 5. And then in bar 6, actually you go back to that. Back to E, I'm going to bring that G sharp back in. And then sometimes he'll go, and you can hear that it's the minor third still, the open G string. So that would be in bar 9. And then B7. And it just struck on the downbeats. One, two. So we're gonna get that open B in there and then the open G at the end. And that open G is just because he's gonna move up to. So this lick here, this would be counting up from the capo, 7th fret, 8th fret. Don't forget, there's our root note. In actuality, it's 9th and 10th fret, but we're always thinking in reference to the capo, transposing. So this goes over, takes the place of the 4 chord, like coming down from the 5. So he doesn't play an A root note, but that's the part of the progression that it's going over. And then you just hold that note and he does this turnaround. So we're just moving that shape down. to the B7 with the thumbed bass note on the bottom. And then it goes back to the top. All right, another tune in standard tuning, capo second fret, is When You Got a Good Friend. It has a very similar beginning with that same kind of turnaround. Robert plays something that's a little more complicated, and he also throws in an extra beat, which is a common thing in country and Delta blues. So many of these guys were unaccompanied musicians, and they could change the blues form as they saw fit to follow their vocals because there was no band playing along with them. And it's just a very common thing to add or subtract beats. And then over the years, those things have just become part of a particular song or particular performance. It makes it kind of cool. In this case, what happens is Robert adds two beats at the beginning. So he goes from 12-8 to 6-8 just to for the contour of this turnaround lick. And then he adds his one beat at the end of the intro. So he sings essentially a pickup for the words, when you've got a good friend, got is going to come in on the downbeat. So the form is a little strange, a little different, but it's another good example of using that turnaround and playing in standard tuning, capo, second fret. One, two, three. Right, as I said, this one is a little more complex in the beginning because there's more picking going on. And the other thing is I'm barring my pinky across the top two strings so I can go, like the beginning is one, two, three, and there's the downbeat. So I'm alternating between the B and the high E string as this note descends. So it begins one, two, three. So there's that alternating with the finger picking between the high E string and the B string. And then you end up with that extra two-beat bar in there, which is interesting. Right here. And then back to 12-8. And then this is kind of a funny turnaround. He goes to A7. So it's a quick A for two beats. And then B7 for two beats. And then here's that extra beat where he sings, when you got a good friend, where the vocal comes in. So it's just an odd form. When you got a good friend. And then you're into the verse and it's the same. So we do that open G and then high E when you go to the four chord in bar two of the verse. So. And you do that again going back to E. And then sometimes does that double pick on the G string. So it ends up with three on the top. And then here, bar five and six, he adds a bar, a whole bar of A, just for the vocal. When you got a good friend. And then he doesn't sing, and then he comes in at the end of the bar. One that stay right by your side. So you end up with an odd number of bars, and it's just to accommodate the vocal. So again, on the four. Well, I'd stay right by your side. Then it goes to the five. Okay, because we're capoed at the first fret, everything fretted is going to be one fret higher than it normally would. So we're in the key of G. So normally we would be here, 12th fret and 10th fret, but we've got to be 13th and 11th. Because here's our transposing G note there. So we start with these little two note figures on the top. So everything descends chromatically like a typical turnaround. And then he picks the open G and the G here, and then comes the turnaround where you keep three frets higher than the capo on the high E string and descend down the D string. We're going to go into D7 with an F sharp bass. Like that. So one more time. And then one thing about this song is the accents on the low strings are very strong. So it's palm muted. And also, it just struck so hard, sometimes you don't even hear a note. You just hear kind of a dead hit as opposed to hearing the bass note. So we start with just that. The G, open B, and the G on top. So that's the open high E. And then we're gonna go third fret of the B, first fret. On the high E with the G on the bottom. So, then we're gonna go. So, second fret with the open E. So this little figure moves down chromatically and back up. And then there in bar four, he just picks it more times. To C. One thing that's cool here on the low hits, you can kind of hear that open low E. Back to G7. To D7 with the thumb, F sharp in the bass, back to G. Then he goes to the two chord, dominant A7. Back to the D7 F sharp bass. You bring in some syncopation between the low strings on the D7 with the F sharp bass. Back to G and a turnaround. Back to D and then back to G. And the form repeats. All right, let's look at another guitar tuning that Robert Johnson liked to use. This is open G. So when you strum across all the strings, you've got a G chord. And Robert would use his tuning either just like this or with a capo, so it'd be transposed. So let's tune to open G. You have D on the bottom, E down a whole step. A is down a whole step to G. And then the D, G, and B strings are normal. And then the high E is down a whole step to D. So load high, D, G, D, G, B, D. And Robert has some very specific chord shapes he would use in open tunings and in open G. And this next example is going to be played in the style of Stones in My Passway, which is primarily played with fretting, but you can see I have a slide on my finger now. When he played slide, very often he would be in open tuning for playing slide. And what's interesting about Stones in My Passway is so much of the song is fretted, but there's just little moments of using the slide. So here's the example along the lines of Stones in My Passway. All right, as you can see, I have the capo at the second fret, so this is sounding an A chord. So it's just like I'm thinking in G, though, so the 12th fret now functions as the 14th fret. And I come in after B2. One, two. So one. So two slide ups, 12 frets above the capo, and then 3 frets above the capo. And then I pick the open 3rd string, open 5th string. And then... So there's this little melody that's created on the top string. 1, 2. So I'm just fretting the top two strings, 3 frets higher than the capo, and then I bring my ring finger on. So I could go back and forth from this G7 transposing chord to G. And then we get into the verse, and on beat one, it's just the open strings, B2. That's B2 and 3. So I go from this shape on beats 2 and 3. And then this rake, high to low, and back to high on beat 2 and 3. 1. So you can see I'm throwing in this slide up the low string too. Right here. Another rake. Then back to the first position. 4 chord. So that's just barring across. 5 frets above the capo. And just putting that ring finger 3 frets higher to make a 7th chord. Back to the first form. Followed by the second form. Then he pauses to sing. There's no real 5 chord. And he just plays this one note. And he comes back on going between that shape for G7 transposing and that shape for G7 to G5. Let's wrap up with a look at one more tuning that Robert Johnson liked to use. This is Open D. You're going to find this on Preachin' Blues and Hellhounds on My Trail. So when you strum across the strings, you have a D chord. And it's akin to the normal E shape, but everything is tuned down. So low to high, you have D, A, D, F sharp, A, and D. So it's great for playing slide, because when you lay across any given fret, you're going to get major chords. All right, for our last example, we are in open D, capoed at the third fret. So it sounds in F, and we have to reach all the way up to the 15th fret to get the same as our root position. And this is going to be played in the style of Ramblin' on My Mind. So I start up here. It's a little difficult to be in tune because I'm past the where the neck joins the body. So I put a vibrato on it. And while I'm sustaining that, I drop the bass notes in. So it's just up the G string to the high E string. And then I went. So that's just on the B and the G string. And then the little walk down, turn around. So here it's just on the A and the D string. Little unison. What would be a D note normally, but now it's F with the capo. And then at the top of the verse, and then, so just repeating that classic kind of dust my broom. Then the four chord, it's five frets above the capo, but looks like the eighth fret, so I'm just barring across and using the ring finger two frets higher. And sometimes back to the one. And that's kind of neat. Just one fret higher in the G string for the suspended. Five chord, 10th fret or 7 frets higher than the capo. And then that same turnaround. But here, I play unison notes for the 5 chord. So in this case, it's a D note in the key of F, but if you were transposing and it was D, it would be an A note. Back to the slide lick on top to start the next verse. All right, I hope you've enjoyed this look at the playing of Robert Johnson, and it's going to inspire you to look into more of his playing. Every single song is like a little perfect composition with all kinds of interesting specific techniques in those songs. You'll hear him in Come On In My Kitchen or in Crossroads, 3220 Blues, all of them are great and definitely worth investigating, and there's so much great playing there. And as I said, it's the bedrock of electric blues, Chicago style, Texas style, with Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf, which of course led to blues rock and roll and everything we knew that came after that. Robert Johnson, one of the most important guitar figures ever. I'm Andy Allidort. See you next time.